World's biggest online vigilante groups, its members break into the computer systems of companies and governments. Hector Monsegur was one of the group's most effective operatives. He was instrumental in steering cyber attacks on targets including Visa, MasterCard, PayPal, Sony, and the U.S. Senate. In 2011, he infiltrated the Tunisian government's website in support of protesters at the height of the Arab Spring. Later that year, he was apprehended after hacking into an FBI affiliate. He became an informant, allowing the government to log his actions as he engaged in hacking activities with his former peers. The FBI says he has helped them prevent more than 300 cyber attacks in systems controlled by the military and NASA. I sat down with him recently for his first television interview, and here is that conversation.
How old were you when you saw your first computer?
I saw my first computer when I was probably 8 or 9. That's when I lived in Ithaca, New York for a while. And it was cool because, you know, I was bored. It was during the summer, and there was nothing to do over there. We had no friends and no family. So it was just basically my family inside of a little house, and we were there pretty much all day, every day. And it just so happens that I think my father or his wife saw an ad or knew somebody that were pretty much giving away a computer, an old Apple system. They brought us to the house with an old dot matrix printer, and I was just sitting there in front of it in wonder, right? I mean, this is something relatively foreign to me. So by tinkering with the system and learning how it functioned, I was able to escape from the current situation we were going through.
So you were self-taught?
Absolutely. I had no one to, you know, everybody around me were into something, but it wasn't computers, you know?
I mean, was it a passion then? I mean, once you had that idle time and you had that device, did it feel like, my God, it's the best thing ever happened to me?
Close to it. Absolutely. I felt like I could create, which is what the most interesting thing. Even if it was as simple, mind you, as a child, I was 8 years old, I would create a document and just write into it, print it out 1,000 times, waste paper. It might seem ridiculous, but it gave me an opportunity to create something.
And how did you learn about hacking?
It started with my interest in, you know, we were poor. I needed a way to get online. And in those days, getting online meant, you know, credit cards, and you had to pay some sort of service provider. So I needed to find a way that would be cheap or free so that I could be able to access the internet without being a burden to my grandmother, who was really poor. And also, you know, growing up, I watched films like War Games, and War Games is an old school film. I also watched even Hackers or Sneakers. These are films that portrayed hacking, so obviously my interest would be peaked as soon as I was able to get online continuously, without interruption.
You were known as Sabu?
Yeah, I was known as, I chose that name probably around 97. Before that, I had a whole different name. It was a random name, which I forgot.
Yeah. Sabu was the name of a professional wrestler.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I used to watch him with my father. Before my father went to prison, me and my father would sit there and watch, you know, ECW at 2 in the morning. And the coolest guy was the guy jumping off of buildings and, you know, doing reckless things, right? His motto was, he was suicidal, homicidal, and genocidal. And mind you, while he's doing that, he's jumping off of buildings, I'm here hacking. And I decided I needed a name, right? I needed a moniker, a pseudonym. So I said, all right, I'll go with that guy. I'll go with Sabu. He's pretty interesting.
So tell me about Anonymous.
Well, Anonymous is, or should be, an idea. Anonymous is an idea. An idea where we could all be anonymous, we could all work together as a crowd, united. We could rise and fight against oppression. That's what Anonymous is.
So, and then there was Lil Sec?
Yeah, Lil Sec was, you could say it was more of a mistake. It was a group that had to be created because what we wanted to do was something that many Anonymous members were not ready for. They were not accepting of it. At the time, Anonymous was more focused on like social protesting and low-scale hacking. They weren't thinking outside the box. So once we did a certain hack, it gained a lot of attention, notoriety, because it was a media, it had to do with media and security. And we kind of got some fame for it. That's when we decided to just focus on LulzSec, because a lot of people in Anonymous simply did not want to take the heat.
Tell me about the feeling when you're hacking.
Oh, thrill. It's actually exciting. It depends on your goal, obviously. I mean, if you're hacking to learn, the thrill is proving your concepts. We call these proof of concepts, POC. Once you can prove your concept, then you have that thrill.
Give me an example of a concept.
If you're trying to prove an exploit, kind of like a mathematician that proves a theory, they'll create an algorithm. And if it works, if it checks out with his colleagues, then, you know, that's his success. In the case of an exploit, we find a vulnerability in a web application or some sort of software.
Tell me how you operated. I mean, you know, how many hacks did you do?
Thousands.
What was the biggest?
My biggest hack to me that actually did something was when I participated in Operation Tunisia, when I helped the Tunisian people, get their revolution. You know, when I helped the people during the
started the Arab Spring.
Well, the Arab Spring started in Tunisia.
Yeah.
And then that's when everything went pretty insane. Like, it was amazing. I saw, finally, I was able to do something that contributed to society, regardless if I was at home, in the Lower East Side, in the projects, behind a computer.
So how'd that make you feel?
Wonderful. I felt great. I felt like I'm finally able to do something that's going to help people. It was just... it was hard, right? Because
yeah,
I did
that's not. I mean, that's a long way using social media and and using hacking to influence a revolution, from targeting companies so that there's monetary gain, right?
Absolutely.
Two very different things. You did both.
Well, you could say that. I mean, I gained access to companies, and when you're accessing these companies, automatically you have access to the database. You have the credit cards instantly right there. It's not a matter of chasing down these credit cards and looking for the credit cards specifically. You're breaking into the machines, you have access to them instantly. I had access to the credit cards.
When did you know the FBI was on to you?
Several days before, a couple weeks before my arrest, because I would come downstairs, take the kids to school, and there's a random Con Edison truck parked in front of my building.
Yes.
How often do you see a Con Edison truck parked in front of the Lower East Side? And then you have random mail. You know,
it should have been an indicator right there.
Well, you know what's the greatest indication?
What?
The mailman was hanging out with the Con Edison guy in front of my building.
Yeah.
It's kind of random. Yeah. So I knew something was off.
There was the night the agent showed up at your door.
Around 8-ish, 9-ish, around that time. It was already dark. And they knock on my door, and they say, police. Mind you, we're not doing anything illegal, so I'm pretty sure, well, besides me, I'm pretty sure it wasn't the police at the door. I said, all right, guys, hold on a moment. I walked to the door. But before I walked to my door, I spoke to my brother. I said, listen, just chill. Relax. Let me handle this. I go to the door, and here we are. We have a whole bunch of FBI agents in the hallway. I remember it was at least 14, 15 of them. They were up and down the staircase doing verticals. We had some guys in suits in the corner, around the corner of my hallway. And, they basically pulled me out into the hallway and said, you know, we're glad you opened the door in time because we're about to smash it in. I said, all right, so what's the problem?
That's what you said?
Yeah.
Why are you here?
Yeah, like, what's up? How can I help you, you know? So they said, well, we know who you are, right? We know who you are. We know what you're doing, and we also know you have two kids in the house. So, to keep it simple, you could either cooperate with us, just come downtown with us, you'll be back in the morning, or we're going to call ACS and we'll take the kids away. It's your call. You make the decision. So it's clear as day they had an understanding that my weakness
was your kids.
Was the kids. Yeah. They did their homework. Props to them. Much respect. That was disgraceful, that entire situation. I would have loved to fight my case. It would have been beautiful. But unfortunately, I was in a situation where I had to lose these two beautiful girls that were innocent and young and didn't have anything to do with any of this. And why would I why would I assist in helping them create emotional complexes that would haunt them for the rest of their lives? I'd rather take the weight, fine, by all means, than have them go through the situation of being taken away and lost in the system.
Okay, in order to keep your kids, you had to do what?
I had to go downtown and admit to my crimes and cooperate with them.
How hard was that?
One of the hardest decisions of my life, but also one of the easiest, because the children were involved. I'm not going to choose an idea or a movement of strangers over these two little girls. So, it was a half and half situation.
So you went to work for the FBI?
It's not that I went to work for the FBI, it's just that I was forced to have my computer logged by the FBI. And it was difficult. It was very hard, but I was able to manage a lot of it.
FBI says that you helped them prevent more than 300 cyber attacks on our government.
Yeah.
The military, NASA. What did you do?
Well, here's the interesting part. What I was doing before my arrest was unifying hackers, right? That was part of what I really did. That was the thing that made me so popular for whatever reason. Unifying hackers, bridging the language gaps, or bridging the hatred between groups or nationalities. So by being someone that, you know, Iranian hackers and Israeli hackers, Pakistani hackers and Indian hackers can come to and share their knowledge and still accomplish their goals, probably on a greater scale, it also put me in a situation where when I was logged by the FBI, they got to see attacks in real time that were taking place against the infrastructure of the United States government. So with that being said, I was able to intercept attacks that were happening against the government and share it with the government so they could fix these issues.
But also, you took down how many? 8 of the world's top hackers.
Well, they could say that I took them down.
Well, they believe you took them down.
I didn't identify anybody. I didn't point my finger at anybody. I didn't ask the question, what's your name? Can I get your IP address? Where do you live?
But would they have been taken down without you?
Absolutely.
They would have gotten.
You want to be realistic? Yeah, absolutely.
But as soon as there was huge advantage in having you there on their side to take down these hackers.
Because they had logs from the computer.
Yeah.
Right? I was there. I was essentially told, do what it is that you do. Just do not attack any American interest, any government networks. So when you're told that, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to continue exactly what I was doing prior to my arrest. Right? So what was I doing prior to my arrest? I was uniting hackers and activists from around the world, correct? After my arrest, I'm doing the same exact thing. Unfortunately, now there's logs. That's the part that really hurt me the most.
Tell me about Jeremy Hammond.
He's an interesting character. He's not as they portrayed him to be. He was just a random activist who had some hacking skills, and he wanted to be part of LoSec, just like many other hackers. But fortunately for them, LoSec was only a team of 6.
Yeah.
But he hung around us, he worked with us, we communicate daily. And once LoSec met its end, he participated with Operation Anti-Security.
You know what some of them are saying. They said you coerced them into doing some stuff.
Well, it's kind of difficult, right? The question is, it bothers me a little bit. Because prior to my arrest, my conversations with people were the same conversations you saw between me and Jeremy Hammond. Oh, you're hacking to the government of Brazil. Awesome. What information did you get? All right, let's share that information and put it on Twitter. So, you're telling me that if I coerced him post my arrest, what happens to all the conversations I had prior to my arrest? Nothing's changed. I did not sway from what I was doing prior. So, no, there was no coercion.
Yeah.
He hacked. I participated. We worked together, same with everybody else.
Prosecutors have revealed that you've been cooperating with them.
No.
An unusual public disclosure.
Yeah, kind of, right?
Yeah.
I mean, from what I gather, doing some research, most informants are usually held secret
exactly.
until trial, and if trial does not happen, they remain secret forever.
Exactly.
I didn't go to trial. Nobody went to trial. So the exposure is kind of baffling to me, to be honest with you.
You don't know why. Or you know why.
I can't give you their perspective, unfortunately.
You can talk to
but
them.
But I'm sure it has to do with some sort of propaganda. I mean, how else would you kill at the centralized movement with no leaders if you were to say that there was a leader?
Mm-hmm.
And his leader was Sabu. And he's compromised, by the way. So what happens after my exposure, if you paid attention to the social atmosphere of Anonymous, panic, fear, people began to fall back from participating in Anonymous operations. Maybe that was their agenda. I mean, it was dissuasive, right? It gave people a reason not to participate with Anonymous if their so-called leader was compromised.
I assume part of the government's attitude is about you, public disclosure, you know, that in the end, we'll get you.
Mm.
You cannot hide behind anonymity. We'll get you. Look who we got.
Yeah.
We caught a big fish.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know what? It wasn't a matter of them just being sophisticated or they're having some insane technology they were able to use to find me. I made mistakes. I made a lot of
That's
mistakes.
That's how people get caught.
That's how people get caught.
What is, at this moment, as we are talking,
mm-hmm.
the worst thing that hackers are capable to do to the United States?
Well, it's a good question. And in all reality, there is no security. With that being said, airport security, hackers will break right into the airport, phone systems, obviously. Power supply systems, turn off the lights, there'll be no lights in here. The water supply systems, shut them down. Oil pipelines, they'll shut down Saudi Arabia for a day, and guess what? The price of gasoline will shoot up to $10 to $20 by tomorrow. Bureau of prisons, where I was locked up at. Scatter systems, the locks are controlled by scatter systems. These are logic controller systems. They could just simply open all the cells across the United States. It's a matter of their goals, what they're trying to accomplish.
Okay, but you're saying that's accomplishment. Those are accomplishments that can be achieved by people who are working today as hackers. They could do every
hackers
one of those things.
Way more than that.
Scary to me.
It could be scary, and it should be an inspiration to the American government to focus on our infrastructure.
To make it more hacker-proof?
Well, it's not about hacker-proof. It's that our way of handling security in this country is completely absurd. For example, instead of educating, let's say this office right here, we're all government employees, right? You're the president and so on. And
you're in charge of security.
Well, yeah, by all means, I'll be security guy, right? So instead of you telling me, hey, Hector, can you educate everybody about their passwords, how to secure their laptops, because we have some sensitive information in here, we don't want to leak. No, that's not what happens in real life. What happens is the government, which you, the president, would call Mantech or Raytheon and say, hey, can you guys come over here and install some software, right? Don't even talk to our people about security. Just install some software, and we're going to give you $1 billion for it. Now, here we come with security contractors. We have a sickening reliance on security contractors, the likes of Booz Allen Hamilton, and Mantech, who were, right, the companies that Edward Snowden worked for.
Right.
Who will guard the guards, Charlie? Our security, the people we pay for, people we hire with tax dollars, are not really secure themselves. So they are our attack vectors. You understand?
I do. Seems like we're in a bad place.
We are in a bad place. We are in a really bad place. And as time goes on, you're going to continue to hear stories like, oh, the Chinese government has infiltrated the post office, right? Or the Russian government has infiltrated the sewage system. It's going to continue to happen until we change our perspective on security. We need to stop treating security as a contract job and accept security as a way of life that we need to think about, right? We all individually have the responsibility to focus on our own security. There's no reason why you should have an intern handle your email. You should be able to handle your own email.
Can you imagine this? Mm-hmm. It is said, and I have no way to judge, that you were really, really good.
I leave it up to people to decide.
No. Can you imagine that if you had not gone one direction, mm-hmm. but had ended up in Silicon Valley?
Well, that's the problem. I didn't end up in Silicon Valley. I had no connections to the world. Here I was, this young, poor Puerto Rican guy from the Lower East Side projects, where no one even knew I existed. I was being racially profiled by the NYPD. I had no formal college education. How was I going to get from there to Silicon Valley? I tried. I did start my own security company. That failed. So with no connections and no help from anybody, it would have been extremely hard for me to make it to where I needed to be. And I guarantee you, though, had I made it to Silicon Valley, had I met you when I was 18, you probably could have pointed me in the right direction.
Right.
You and I would be having a completely different discussion.
Thank you, Hector.
Thank you.
For more about this program and early episodes,